Hello guys, Dr. Hasbullah here, and in this video we're going to be looking at how to find forces on curved surfaces. Now I know that finding force in the inclined surface is quite complex, and it may seem like finding forces on the curved surface is even more complex, but I assure you it's the other way around. And in what condition that we need to find forces on the curved surface? So as an example, if you have something that looks like this, so this is the wall. Okay, and this is another wall. And then you have something that looks like a stopper over there. And you have the curved surface over here. Okay, and this is your hinge, right? And this is the water level. And in this condition, we know that the force that acts on this surface, okay, will look something like this, right? So that will be the force. But in order to find this force, we're going to separate it into two components, which is in horizontal components and also in vertical components. And because we separate it into vertical and horizontal component, the calculation and the procedure to get it is much simpler. Okay, now let's take this area of the surface, right? And I'm going to draw it again here. So this will be your surface, and this is the boundary of the water. And when I say that we separate the components into vertical and horizontal components, that means that this surface has now carried vertical and horizontal components. And I'm going to label it here as FH, which is horizontal, and FV, which is vertical. And what are the forces that comes from the water above that surface, right? And in vertical component, basically you have the forces from the pressure here. This is the forces from the pressure above this region, and I'm going to call it F2. Okay, and we also have the weight of the water itself on top of the surface. Okay, so I'm going to call this FW. And also from the left hand side, you also have pressure coming in from the left. Therefore, you have a force from the left. Okay, and this force looks something like this, isn't it? Because pressure change in Z direction. So the deeper you are into the water, the higher the pressure. Okay, so the pressure distribution should look something like this. Okay, and I'm going to call this F1. If you notice, FH and FV is the forces that keep the surface static. So without FH and FV, the surface would be gone. F2 and FW is actually the pressure that is opposite of FV. So FV, if I take the summation of force in Y direction, and positive will be upward. So FV minus F2 minus FW equal to 0. So F2 plus FW is FV. So the vertical force is the force from the water because of the pressure, plus the force from the weight of the water, right? And if I take a summation of force in X direction, right being my positive, so F1 minus FH equal to 0. So F1 is actually my horizontal force. To find the FH and FV, what we need therefore is F2, F1 and FW. Okay, so how do we find F2? Right? F2 is simply pressure times this area. Okay, this area. Area 2. Okay, and this is area 2. And to find F1, we need to find this F times this area. Okay, it's just like solving a plane. Right, a vertical and a horizontal plane. It's that simple. Okay, so this becomes your area 1. Okay, so this is pressure times area 1. And FW is simply the weight. Okay, and weight is actually density times volume. So when you find the volume that is on top of the surface, and then you know the density of water is 1000 kilogram per meter cube. So when you have these three components, you basically have your vertical force and your horizontal force. That is very simple as compared to the inclined plane just now, isn't it? So now let's take a look at one example so that you get to understand how simple it is to calculate these vertical and horizontal forces for the curved surface. So what I have here is a curved surface that looks something like this. And this is my water line. Okay, so this is my water level. So this surface has the force that acting on the right, which is P, and this is my hinge. Okay, this is hinge. And I need to find what is P in order to keep the surface static. So again, this is my surface. And I need to find P to hold this door static. Okay, imagine that this is the door. And the good thing is that this is a semicircle with the radius of 2 meter. And the distance between P and water level is 0.5 meter. Before we do anything, let's just draw a free body diagram. And I'm going to start with the surface. Okay, so this is my surface. And I'm also going to draw the water that is close to the surface, right? So what I have here, this is my hinge. So this is where I have my Fy and also Fx. And I think my surface extends a little bit longer. Okay, so that I can have my P here. That is my force. That is the force that I'm looking for. And this is the water. Okay, this is the water. Right, and I have here my F1 and F2 just to be consistent with my example here. So F1 is on a horizontal plane. So this is my F1 and this will be my F2 and this will be my weight of water. So this is my FW and I'm also going to label this as D1 and here is D2. And here is my DW. So DW is the distance between this hinge to the centroid of the area. Why do we need to find the centroid? Because the force FW, which is the weight of the water, acts on the centroid of the area. What area? Definitely this area. Now, what do we do next? Of course, we're going to have to find each of these parameters. First, let's find F2 and then we find F1, we find FW, and then we find the location that is D2, D1, and DW. And finally, we're gonna do summation of moments at this point. Okay, why not I do it now so that we have a reference? So if this is point O, and if I take the summation of moment at point O, clockwise being my positive direction, so this will be P times, that is 0.5 plus 2, so 2.5 meter, minus F1 D1 plus FW DW minus F2 D2. Okay, and this is equal to 0. So that is the equation that I need to solve. But first, let's find the magnitude and also the location of each of the forces. So F1 is basically rho g h bar 1 times area 1, isn't it? So rho g is 9810. Now, what is h bar 1? Okay, when we are dealing with the curved surface and when we are dealing with F1, okay, so F1 is the force that is perpendicular to the vertical plane. And we're going to treat the area as square or rectangle. Why is that? Because we already resolved it into horizontal and vertical plane. If you have a surface that looks something like that, and when you look from this side, okay, what you see is actually rectangle, right? You don't see the curvature of the surface, you just see rectangle. Similarly, if you look from the bottom, what you see is just rectangle. So, when you are dealing with F1, your area here is actually a rectangle. Okay? And this rectangle has the height of this distance, which is 2 meter, and the width of, I forgot to tell you the width, so the width of this gate is 4 meter. Okay, so this gate is 3-dimensional gate, so you can view it as something like this. Okay, so it's a 3-dimensional gate. Okay, that's your curved surface. Okay, so let me draw this plane again properly. Okay, so this plane should look something like this, where this length will be 2 meter and this is 4 meter. So h bar is the distance between the centroid of that plane to the water level. Okay, and because the centroid is here, okay, so my h bar is 1 meter. Okay, so this is 1 meter. And my area will be 2 meter times 4 meter. This is 2 times 4. And this will give you 9810 times 2 times 4. 78,480 Newton. Okay. Now, what about F2? F2 is also rho g h bar 2 A2. As usual, rho g is 9810. Now, what is h bar 2? So, this plane is here, and the plane is at horizontal level, and the distance from the water level is 2 meter. And because it is horizontal, so all the distance is 2 meter. That includes h bar for 2 as well. So, this is simply 2 meter. And the A2 is also 2 meter times 4. Because the surface is a semicircle, right? And this will equal to 156,960 Newton. And finally, what is FW? So FW is simply the force because of the weight of the water. So weight of the water is rho times volume. And to convert it to force, you must multiply it with gravity. So this is 9810 times the volume of the water here. And to find the volume of the water, we need to multiply the width, which is 4. That is the width of this plate. And then we need to do square area minus semicircle. Okay, so square is simply 2 times 2, and this is minus the semicircle, the quarter circle. So this is pi times 2 square divided by 4. Does it make sense? Okay, and this gives you 4 minus pi times 4 times 9810. So the force because of the weight of the water is 33,684 Newton. Okay, now we have solved all the magnitude, right? And we have solved for this, this, and this. And now we need to find D1, D2, and DW. Okay, I'll deal with DW later. It looks slightly complicated. So D1, what is D1? Okay, if I draw this plane again, okay, this is my plane. Okay. And this is my F1, and this is my D1, and the pressure is going to look something like this, isn't it? Okay, that is what I'm dealing with in terms of pressure. Okay, so immediately I know that because it forms a triangle, I know that the center of pressure, so this might be the center of gravity, C, and so this is CP. So the center of pressure, if it shapes like a triangle, then it's going to be 1/3 from the base. Okay, so this length is 2 meter. So 1/3 from the base, so D1 is simply 2 over 3. So this is 0.667 meter. It is also simply possible to find this using I. Okay, so YCP is equal to Y bar plus I over Y bar times area. So what do we do now is we know that Y bar is simply 1 meter. Okay, so this is 1. Plus I for a rectangular plate is BH cubed over 12. B is 4 meter, so this is your B, and H is 2 meter, so this is 2 cubed divided by 12. And if I put in this equation, so this is 4, 2 cubed over 12, and Y is still 1, and then area is 2 times 4. And this becomes 1 plus, and I can cancel 4 out, and I can also cancel 2 out, so this becomes 2 square. So it will be 1 plus 4 over 12, and that is equal to 1.333. But remember, that is YP. Okay, so this is YP. So to find D1, so D1 plus YP equal to 2 meters, so D1 is going to be 0.667, right? And as you notice, it doesn't matter which one you use, you will end up with 0.667 meter. But if you have a triangle that looks something like this, it is much quicker just to calculate a third from the base, because the centroid for a triangle is a third from its base. So that's D1 over with. Now let's find D2. So D2 here is simply 2 divided by 2. Because it's a horizontal surface, the force that act will be at the center of the surface. Okay, so that's quite simple. So D2 is equal to 1 meter. Let's just highlight this so we can use it later. And let's see what we have solved to complete this equation. So D1 is done, D2 is done. Now it's time to find DW. So how do we find DW? So this W is going to be a little bit tricky. So basically, the surface looks something like this, isn't it? So this is what the surface looks like. This is your centroid and this is your DW. Okay, and this surface is actually a combination, or rather a subtraction of this surface minus this surface, isn't it? So if we know the centroid of this, and I'm going to call this X1, and if we know the centroid of this, which I'm going to call X2, we can develop the equation whereby DW, and I'm going to call this area 1 and this is area 2. Area 1 minus area 2 is equal to X1 times area 1 minus X2 times area 2. Okay, I think we can find this quite easily so that we can find DW. So DW, A1 is this, I think we know that this is 2 meter times 2 meter. Okay, so this is 4 minus, and our area 2 is pi times 2 square divided by 4, right? That simple. And X1 is going to be 1, because we know the centroid for the square is just at the middle of the square. So this will be 1 times 4 minus, now X2, what is the formula for the centroid of a quarter circle? This is semicircle, quarter circle, centroid. And that will be 4r over 3 pi. So this is 4r over 3 pi. Okay, so 4r over 3 pi times A2 is pi times 2 square over 4. So now I think we can easily find DW. So DW is equal to 4 minus, I'm going to cancel this out, and I'm also going to cancel this pi, and we're going to end up with 4 times 2 divided by 3 over, this can be cancelled out, so 4 minus pi, and we'll end up with DW equal to 8 divided by 3, 4 minus pi, divided by 4 minus pi. So dW is equal to 1.553 meter. Okay, so apparently the most challenging parameter to find is actually dW. It's a geometrical parameter rather than the actual pressure. Now that we have everything, we have dW here, so I'm gonna write this equation again. So 2.5P, or I'm just gonna copy it here, right? So let's do this. Copy and paste it here. So now 2.5P minus F1D1. F1 is 78,480 times D1, which is 0.667, plus FW is 33,684 times DW is 1.553 minus F2 is 156,960 times D2 is, I think it's 1. Okay, now it's time to find P, and P is equal to
78480 times 0.667 plus 156,960 minus 33684 times 1.553. Divide everything with 2.5.
And the final answer would be P equal to 62798 newton, or simply 62.8 kilonewton, right? And that is your final answer for P. Okay, and that will be your P. Okay, everyone, and that is how you find the force on the curved surface. I think because you can resolve it into vertical and horizontal component, the calculations get a lot easier as compared to the force at the inclined surface. And of course, as usual, you can repeat this example as much as you want until you understand how to find the force on the curved surface. So that's all for this video. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.